Romans chapter 12, verse 3 through 8. And it reads, "For though the grace given to me, I say to every man among you, not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but think as to be sound judgment, God has allotted to each a measure of faith. For God, just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we, who are many members, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. And since we have gifts that different according to grace given to us, let each exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, according to the portion of faith; if service, in his serving; or if he who teaches, in his teaching; or he who exhorts, in his exhortation; he who gives with liberality; he who leads with diligence; he who shows mercy with cheerfulness." The title of our message today is Real Unity.
Amen.
Real
unity.
You know, the word unity means that we're supposed to be together. Real unity means that we are having the same function, we have the same direction, we have the same goal. Real unity means that you are with me and I'm with you. Real unity means that I need you and you need me. We are all a part of God's body.
Amen, amen.
Real unity. Well, here today in the text, Paul was talking to the church, and he was talking to the church about dedication of service. And when he was talking about dedication of the service, he says that, "I urge you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable service." Now he's getting the believers to understand that you need to be a living sacrifice.
Right.
You need to understand that when you are dedicated to serving, you'll be able to give up yourself in order for serving in God's body.
Amen.
Here he's telling us that he says to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is our reasonable service. And this is what we're supposed to do as Christians, as believers. And then he comes down and he says that while you're doing this, do not be conformed to this world.
All right.
But be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Amen.
Your renewing of your mind. That means that you need to be able to transform your thoughts and have your thoughts transform into the way God wants you to think.
All right.
Not to be conformed by your environment or your situation or where you come from, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let this mind be in you that is also in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
That's all I'm saying. But then he comes down here to the text, and I like this because, see, now he's saying here, he said, for through the grace given to me, that I say to every man among you,
all right,
do not think of yourself, do not think more highly of yourself than you ought to think.
Amen.
See, when you are in part of unity and you are considering being in unity, you first got to have a self-evaluation.
Right.
You got to evaluate yourself. The thing about evaluating yourself is that you got to understand that when you do a self-evaluation, that you come down and know where you stand.
Right.
Or you got to know what, like Clint Eastwood would say, every man must know their limitations.
All right.
You got to do a self-evaluation, because right here, Corinthians tell us the same thing in a different format. It letting us know that when you are in your form of service, when you are in unity, some of us, when we get together, we think we better than others.
All right.
We, some of us, get the big head when we started doing our service. He says that it, by us doing this, by us coming together, our head gets swelled when we come down to our service,
all right,
when we are sacrificing to a holy God.
All right.
He dealt with this. He dealt with this. Now, let me see what he says here. He says that, he said, we should not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to. You know how you start thinking about how we get, think of ourselves higher than we ought to? That we believe that we can do everything, that we big enough and bad enough to do. And yet we trust in God. Yes, we trust in God that nobody else can do what we do.
Right.
What I'm saying is that when we start doing the will of God, when some of us start doing what God has called us to do in our ministry and in our lives, when we start doing those things that God has required us, we think we're better than us.
All right,
all right.
We think that we have it all together and nobody can do it quite like I can.
Right.
Oh, but he got a message for us here. It says not only that we should not be, he said that we should not be think that we ought to, but think of ourselves with sound judgment.
Amen. All
right.
Sound judgment. That means that we got to give an accurate account of what we're capable of doing.
All right. Amen.
That accurate account, we got to do right. some reconciliation on how we do our service.
All right.
Reconciliation means we can't do the things that we think we can, but we got to be able to do what we know we can. Because, see, you got to understand that he want us to have a equating, he want us to have an accurate evaluation of our service.
Amen.
What's an accurate evaluation of our service? An accurate evaluation of our service is know what we study and speak about what we study about. Oh, but y'all are happy here. To know what we have been called to do and know that we are able to do what we was called to do.
Amen.
That's what he said. He said he want an accurate evaluation
Amen.
Of our situation. In order for us to be unified, we got to know that we are accurately evaluating ourselves to be formed of this body,
right.
To be a part of this body.
Amen.
I like that because, see, now he's going to let us know something. He says, now, after we have a sound judgment, after we have a real judgment on where we are in Christ, after we have a real judgment in Christ, it says here that God has allowed it to each a measure of faith. That's good news. See, the King James said, man, it says that instead of says allotted, he said God have dealt each man a level of faith.
Amen.
But see, what allotted means that each one of us, God has given us faith.
All right.
That same faith that we showed this morning, the size of a mustard, God has passed it out to each and every one of us who believes in him.
All right.
Okay? Now, if he have allotted each and every one of us faith, that means that what he have allotted us, that means that we are allowed to allow it to grow the way God wanted to grow. Because a lot means that just because I gave you a lot don't mean it's the same faith for each and every one of us.
All right.
The same faith. My faith may be the size of a mustard seed. Your faith may be the size of a mountain. But all you got to understand is that God allowed each one of us to have faith.
Yeah.
See, that's what unifies us. Is that faith that we believe in Christ Jesus. And died. That's all he wants us. He let them know that God have allotted us. That's what unites us. That a lot of the faith that he has given each and every one of us.
Amen.
That God have allotted to each one a measure of faith. A measure of faith. The believing factor in this body that unites us is our faith.
Amen.
In this body, you got to be on one accord in this body, as Paul is trying to let us know. And let's see what he's talking about here and being part of the body. He says in verse 4, he said, for just as we are many members in one body, and all the members does not have the same function. All
right.
So now God has allotted us, each one of us, a measure of faith. He has given each one of us a level of faith. But with that faith, also given us different functions.
Amen.
Different functions are different parts of the ministry, different parts of the body, different parts that God needs us to do certain things. In the human body, we have our hands, we have our feet, we have our legs, we have our heart, we have our lungs. And each one of those members have to play their part.
All right.
I mean, y'all ain't with me here. That each one of them got to play their part in the body.
Yeah.
But they all don't have the same function. The ear is not able to see.
Amen.
The mouth ain't able to hear.
Amen.
I mean, y'all ain't with me here.
All right. I'm on.
See, each one play their own part. All
right.
And in the body of Christ, we each need to play our part. All
right.
We need to play our part to the fullest. All
right.
It's gonna help us here. It's gonna help us here. He said that we gotta remember that we are connected. We may do different things in the body. One may have the faith the size of a mountain. One may be able to give with generosity. One of us may be able to preach like God knows. The sun may come down. One of us may be able to teach that profounds people the way God wants to be found. Some of us may be able to be an usher that help usher in the people. Somebody may be able to exhort somebody else to lift them up. All this is wrapped up into the body of Christ.
Amen.
Right.
And if this is wrapped up to the body of Christ, we are all connected in one.
Amen.
If we're not connected, if the body is not different, I mean, if the body didn't have different functions, then the body would be, I would say, L-formed or deformed, because the body, everybody can't be a foot.
Amen.
Everybody can't be a hand. Everybody can't be an ear. Everybody can't be a leg. Everybody can't be the same. But we all are different. The Bible says we all are different. But when we come together, it's the completeness of the body.
Amen.
If that's what he wants to let us know. He wants to let us know in verse 4. He said, remember that we all different, but we all one.
Amen.
We all one. We got one direction, one purpose.
All right.
To do the will of God all our different talents and all our different abilities. We ought to be able to give God the glory. See, not only that, it says here in verse 4, it says different functions, but it says, so we who are many members, are one body. We are many. In one body. But see, he shows us the connecting factor.
Amen.
The connecting factor is Christ.
All right.
The connecting factor of making us united is through Christ.
All right.
What that means? That means that our actions on whatever gift we have must glorify God in
all
what
right.
we do.
Amen.
It must represent who we are or who we are part of. And we are part of Christ.
Amen.
It says that in Christ, and individually members of one another. Individual members of one another. So that means that we are connected. We are one. We are one in unity, but we are one through Christ Jesus. If it had not been for his shedding of blood, there would not be no remission of sin. It would not be no adoption for us to be part of this body, what he's saying here. This body of Christ is what we need to be able to be a part of that gives God the glory.
That's right.
That's right.
That's let's see what we have now. He says there, and he jumps down here in verse 6. And since we have the gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let each exercise them accordingly. Read that one more time. It says, let each exercise them accordingly.
Amen.
Each one of us have a different gift.
Amen.
What it's saying here is that we must exercise them accordingly. But what I found out, Pastor, is that we as believers, and as you see us living this life that God has called us to live, exercising is kind of hard on some folks.
Okay.
I mean, y'all ain't happy.
All right.
Exercise, some people don't want to exercise. They find them, they have an excuse.
All
some
right.
of us have
all
a reason right. why not to. Some of us are too busy to.
Right.
Exercise. exercise the way God has wanted us to exercise. Right. But here is saying, right. here is saying in the text that if you got an ability that God is using, or if you have a gift right. that God is using, right. you must exercise that gift. Now, let's have you here, because right. I'm trying to tell you that if you understand that God is saying, well, if I gave you this gift by your measure of faith, I need you to exercise.
All right.
How do you exercise the gift that God told you to do? You need to, first of all, start to work.
All right.
See, unity, right. unity. I'm going to give a definition right. of unity. It's not that we are always together, but unity is action.
Amen.
Unity is action. What it's saying is that you got to put it to work. See, if you're going to be a teacher, you need to be able to exercise your gift in teaching.
Amen.
If you are preaching, you must exercise your gift in preaching.
All right.
If you are ushering, you must exercise your gift in ushering. Y'all ain't with me. If you are one who exhortates, then you need to exercise your gift in exhortation. Y'all ain't with me here. And when you are in this part of the body, you've got to work this part of the body out. See, the problem with the body, what the problem with the church now is that a lot of us don't want to exercise.
All right. How good. Exercise.
Look at some of our shapes now. Some of us don't want to exercise now.
All right, preacher.
We don't want to exercise when it comes down to the Spirit of God. We don't want to lift up that spiritual food sometimes. We don't want to be able to exercise our strength in God.
All right.
He said to me, by the light of faith that God has given us, we must exercise.
Amen.
Exercise means we need to put it to work. To use it. He's going to come back and show us a little bit more what we need to do. He says in verse 6, he says that we need to exercise it. He says, in prophecy, according to the portion of faith. What that means is, prophecy. My commentary tells me that this word prophecy doesn't mean that we come up and have a divine revelation from God and that he have a new prophecy that he won't fulfill. It doesn't mean that. This means that when God have given you his word, this person over here who got the gift of prophecy is to get God's word to be able to give it to the people the way God wanted it for them to have it through the Spirit. What that simply means is when you go knocking on somebody's door and you tell them the good news of Jesus Christ, you don't add nothing to it and you don't take nothing away to it, but you give it to them with the Spirit of God from the Word of God. That's all it means. Now, Pastor, I like that because see, another one is going to come up. It's going to talk about teaching. And I thought it was real similar, but yet it's something different about this prophecy. This prophecy means that you're going to go and you're going to tell somebody what thus said the Lord from the Word of God.
Amen.
And let the Spirit of God come in and rectify and change that person's heart. Y'all ain't happy here. Because see, this person here who got this gift of prophecy has to be able to tell somebody just how it is.
All right.
And let God do the work in it.
Amen.
Y'all ain't happy here. Because see, when you realize that it's not you giving the word, see, that's the exercise in the fact is that you know that you have given it your best and you let God do the rest.
Amen.
That's the whole part of this gift here. He said you need to exercise it in order for the body to be healthy. This part of the body has to be exercised. That means that the word of God has to be exhorted outside and let somebody tell them what thus said the Lord in order for this part of the body to get strong. And then he gets on to it. He says that in this body, look at it. It says in this body, that is another one. If service in his servant.
Amen.
See, this is another part of the body that we need to work as a body of believers.
All right.
You need to work on the exhortation, meaning the word of God. You need to work on the prophesying. That means the preaching of the word. That means giving forth the word, the pronouncing of the gospel, the true word. From the word of God, which is the prophetic word of God. You're supposed to work on that. But he says not only that, but the word go for it, you need somebody to serve.
Amen.
In this member, this particular member, a servant is a unique service. Can I help you here?
All right.
Because you got to realize that this service here is not the service of the world, but this
Amen.
All right.
And y'all ain't happy.
Amen.
This servant, or this person who exercises his servant, he exercises serving the body.
All right.
How do you serve the body? When somebody's going through, you take them some food. When somebody's sick in the hospital, you go by visiting them. When somebody's hurt and going through, you go to their house and you pray for them. This is what the service is. If you see the body in need, you are able to help the body out.
Yeah.
This is a key member of the body, one of the key members parts of the body that Paul is recognizing here, that we need to be more of a servant.
All right.
Amen.
If you're going through, or if you need my services, I should be ready and available. If that's my gift.
All right.
If that's my gift, I should be able to serve you the way Christ wants me to serve you.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Not only that, he says that we should be able to serve one another and exercise that. That means that when you have the opportunity to serve, stop serving.
Yes, sir.
Amen. That's all it means. Yes, so unity is not only that, but it's action. So you're going to have to take action in serving. Yeah. Not saying that you're going to be like some people say, I'm with you. Some people say, I'm with you, not really with you.
All right.
But now, some people say, oh, we together, but they're not really together with
all
you.
All right.
But here it says that if you have been called in this part of the ministry to serve, then you need to be with it. What I mean by the need to be with it, that you gotta be able to serve while you serve. How can I consider you being a servant if you don't serve?
All right.
How can I honestly say that you're serving if you're not serving?
Amen.
That's all Paul was saying. He's saying that we need to get busy. If we're part of the serving ministry, that we need to get busy about being servants. Right. That's the only way you can recognize a true servant.
Amen.
Let's see what this says here. It says that he who teaches in his teaching. Now, Paul, what are you saying? You're saying that if you have the gift of teaching, the only real reason why I can identify you as being a teacher is that you're a teacher.
Amen.
That you're a teacher.
All right.
That you are doing. That you are part of this.
All right.
See, you can say you're a teacher all day long, but
amen.
You can say that you are doing this thing, but are you doing it?
Amen.
The only real reason I can recognize you is in your actions.
Amen.
If you want to be part of this unity body, you got to have some action about yourself to be identified as part of the body. You got to be doing something. See, the whole thing here is Paul was trying to let the body know in their dedication to service is that you got to be doing something.
Amen.
Let's see, not only that he said you got to be doing it, but you got to be teaching. And you're teaching, you got to. Who teaches in the teaching? It means that teachers gotta be able to teach.
Amen.
They gotta be looking for other ways in order for them to teach. They gotta exercise their gift in teaching. They gotta start teaching. Not only that they start teaching, but they gotta be able to have the ability to teach.
Amen.
Not only have the ability to teach, but willing to want to teach when the opportunity is available.
Amen.
They got to exercise this gift. If not, the body is not going to be in shape the way God wants it to be. Because if we're not teaching, if we're not prophesying and like God wants to prophesy, if we're not doing what God has told us to do in service, we fail to give God the glory.
Amen.
We fail to give God the glory in what we do.
All right.
If you say you're connected, are you really with them?
All right.
Are you really with them?
All right.
When it comes down to serving God, when it comes down to speaking on God's behalf, or when it comes down to teaching God's word. See, when you're teaching, you got to be able, like the Bible says, study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman need not be ashamed, rightfully dividing the words of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15. You got to realize that when you are that teacher, you got to be able to give God's word the way God wants to give it to him.
Amen.
But now I got to go back and I got to revert back to my commentary, because my commentary told me the difference between the prophecy and the teaching was that the teaching is practical.
Amen.
In today's world.
Amen.
Y'all ain't with me here. So when it's telling me that if I am called to be a teacher, that means that my life needs to line up with what I'm teaching.
Right.
Y'all ain't happy
right.
here.
Right.
My life, if I tell you the right way to come out of your situation, I should be able to have the direction and apply the directions in my life as well.
Amen.
That's the difference between the what is that prophet? See, make me stuck there. I'm good. I'm working with you. Here it is. It says, with prophecy. The difference between prophecy is that you tell them the word of God directly from what God has said in his word. And God and the Holy Spirit is what changes things.
Amen.
All right.
The difference between teaching is that you are living this application that you are telling somebody else.
Amen.
I'm not happy. That means that I need to, if I'm going to tell you to live right, I need to walk right.
Yeah.
If I'm going to tell you how to speak right, then I need to keep my mouth shut on certain situations.
Amen.
If I'm telling you how to keep your finances in order, why am I in debt?
That's right.
That's the difference between prophecy and teaching. So if you're a teacher, you got to be able to apply what you have been taught. When you apply,
live it.
Thank you, Mama. When you live in the word of God, that you are teaching somebody else, that will give them strength to come out.
Amen.
Step by step, it's easier for you to teach somebody if you live.
Amen.
It's much easier.
That's right.
Because if they see your lifestyle, they can go about doing your lifestyle. But if you are saying one thing and doing another, you're not teaching.
Right.
That's why Paul said in the text, if you're a teacher, then you show your teaching abilities.
Amen.
Show your way you teach. And how you teach is how you live.
Amen. That's right. Yes,
you can't tell me 2 + 2 = 4 and you can't prove it. You can't tell me how to live this life if you don't know how to live.
Amen.
Let's see.
Amen.
See here, he says that. He says, I'm teaching. Keep on teaching. And he says, he who exhorts in his exhortation. He exhorts. In his exhortation. So if you know to lift people up, if you know to give people encouraging words,
if you know for building people up,
the only way we can recognize who you are is when you're doing exercising, exhortating people. That's the only way we can recognize who you are is by you and doing. By your actions showing that you're lifting folks up. You can't lift me up and then tear me down at the same time.
No.
It won't work. It's not applicable. It's not applicable to the situation if you gonna try to lift me up and tear me down at the same time. It's saying here that in this thing here, if you're gonna be sitting that you're gonna exhortate, then you need to have the exhortation. That means that you have the action of lifting people up. Don't tell me how to get up, and don't show me how to get up. Don't try to build me up if you have never been built up yourself. Don't try to lift me up to the point of to where my head is swollen if you don't know how to lift me up with the exhortation of God.
Amen.
If you can't lift me up without the, you cannot lift me up without the exhortation of God. You can't lift me up. Because all you're going to do is swell my head up if you lifted me up without the exhortation of God.
Amen.
So Paul is saying that you must be able to exhort someone to lift them up. And in your actions of doing it, that's when we recognize that's your gift. When you constantly lifting people up, letting them know, hey, this is the way God intended to do it. This is the way you need to come out of your sins. Hey, you know, God don't like that. You know, that's in his word. He said you need to come out of there in order for you to be a better people. Baby, I know you can do it. Come on, you can
all
do
right,
it. Sometimes you got to say, hey, knucklehead, you know better. Get your butt up and do it. All that is part of being exhortation, meaning they're lifting you up to the point where God wants us to. give somebody, to be able to lift somebody up, to build them up to where God wants them to be. That's all Paul was telling him here. He's saying that in unity, you got to be doing what God asks you to do. That's all unity means, that you got to be a part of this. You got to be part of doing. Not only that, it says lifting people up, but he says here, look, look what it says. It says that in verse 8, it says that he who gives with liberality. He who gives in a liberality. What that means is, if you are known as a giver, if you are known as a giver, show how much you give. Because, you know, some people have, when they give for a purpose, so people can see what they're doing. Mm-hmm. Some people give just so other folks can say, oh, well, they gave a whole lot. But when you give with liberality, that means that you are constantly giving because you believe that God is able to restore that which you have given. Amen. I mean, happy. When you have, when you give it a liberality, you believe that I can give all that I have to help somebody else because I know that God will supply my needs. I mean, y'all are happy. It's saying that when I give in liberality means that I can give you as much as you need as long as I got. That's all it means. Liberality means that if I'm going to give to you, I'm going to give you my best. I'm not going to give you my trash. I'm going to give you what God wants me to give to you liberally. It means I'm going to constantly give it to you over and over again as long as God keeps providing it for me.
Amen.
Y'all ain't happy here. If I'm a giver and you in need, I'm going to give it to you the best way I can give it to you. Meaning that if I have enough to bring you out and God asks me to give it to you, I'm going to give it to you to my fullest. And that's all he's asking. That's why Paul is saying it. Right. He said, if you're a giver, if you're a person who loves to give, give through your heart, then the only way I can recognize you is that the way you give. It's not how you, it's not what you give, it's the way you give. That's the liberality part of it. It's the way that I can express the way God has provided for me to give for you. That's all Paul is letting them know.
Amen.
And let's see what else. I'm almost finished here. It says that, he says, and he who leads, lead with diligence. He who leads, leads in diligence. If you consider yourself a leader, if you are part of this part of the ministry or this part of the body in leadership, then what he's saying here, if you're going to lead, lead this thing for real.
Amen.
Lead this thing in
as
much as you possibly can by leadership.
Amen.
What that simply means is, in order for you to be a good leader, you have to be a great follower.
Amen.
So
Amen.
If you are a great follower in him,
yes,
then you can lead diligently.
That's right. All right.
That's all he's saying. You can lead duty, but you got to be able to follow instructions from the leader.
All
right. Amen. Not only that, it says, let me read that one more time. It says that he who leads, lead diligently. Now, see, the problem with leaders, and the problem with a lot of us who want to be leaders, is that a lot of us want to be leaders in a position, but we're not lifting that position up to the level that it's supposed to be lifted
up. Right.
All right.
A lot of us want to lead in that position, but we want to bring that level of that leadership down to the level where we are.
All right.
Instead of doing it diligently, meaning that when we're in that position, God has ordained us in that position, that we are going to do the best of our ability to lift that position up. To lift that position up to where God wanted to be lifted up to. We're going to be able to do what it takes to lift that position up because it's about giving God the glory.
Amen.
It's not taking a step back because I got this position and I'm going to stay right here.
Amen.
I have been called into this office.
Amen.
I have been called into this office, but I'm not willing to uplift this office.
Hmm. Amen.
Or I want the respect of being in this office, but I haven't earned the respect of being in this office. Are you with me? Do it make sense?
Yes, sir.
Not only that you have to lead and lead diligently, but here it says that, here, and it says, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness.
My Lord.
Amen.
My Lord.
He that shows mercy.
Cheerfulness.
Show with cheerfulness.
Amen.
If you have mercy on somebody.
Yes.
If you show mercy on somebody, that means that you are showing them favor, unmerited favor,
yes,
something that they deserve, that you was able to show them favor in. Don't do it in anger. Do it cheerfully.
Amen.
You've done it for a reason.
All right.
You've done it for a reason. If you show mercy, show it cheerfully.
Yes. Yes.
I'm close to here.
Amen.
Because when you think about showing it and showing it, when you're showing mercy and you're showing it cheerfully, it goes back to tell me that reminds me of that God so loved the world.
Yes.
That he gave his only begotten Son.
Yes.
That whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
God gave his Son.
Yes.
Not only did he give his Son, but for mercy's sake, for our sake, his Son had to die.
Amen.
His Son had to go up Golgotha's hill. See, this gift here is not just no easy gift. All these gifts that Paul is saying, it's not easy. It's not easy being a giver. It's not easy to exhortate. It's not easy to be a servant. It's not easy to teach. It's not, you may think so. It's not easy to lead. You may think this is easy. But in these gifts that Paul is talking about, it's going to take God guiding you through. Can I help you here? Because when you think about it, it takes God guiding you through, that means that you got to be unified in the one body. You got to be connected to the real source in order for you to be a part of this body. And what Paul is telling us here, if we want to serve, if we want to be considered unified, or if we want to be in unity, we must be able to serve.
Yeah.
Or we must be able to do things. We must be able to step out on action. We must exercise the gift that God has placed in us. Can I help you with some exercising of gift? See, it came down 42 generations that God has sent forth his Son, Jesus, into this world. He was born in Bethlehem. He came through 42 generations. Not only did he came through 42 generations, but when he grew up, he walked the dusty shores of Galilee. He unstopped deaf ears. He gave sight to the blind. See, you got to exercise this thing. You got to understand that he was deity. He was 100% man as well as 100% God. See, he had to exercise the fact that he had some humanity, and yet he was still God. See, when he came down to 42 generations and walked the dusty shores of Galilee, see, he came by here just to make sure that we get this thing right. He came by just so we can be able to show us how to live. He came through so we can know that God loves us enough that he gave his only begotten Son. And as he went up to God, got to him, they hung him wide. They stretched him wide. He hung his head, and then he died. That's love, right? But see, that's not how the story ends. 3 days later, he got up with all power in his hand.
Right.
Did he do it?
Yes, he did.
Did he do it?
Yes, he did.
That's that grace. See, that's that grace. Right. If you want to be a part of the wise body, you got to exercise the gift that God has placed in you.
Right.
If you've been called to preach, you need to preach.
All right.
If you've been called to teach, you need to teach.
All right.
If you've been called to nurture, you need to nurture.
All
if you've called to be in the choir, you need to sing.
All
if you've been called to
all of it.
If you've been called to urgent, then you need to urgent.
Amen.
My Lord.
If you've been called by God, if you want to be part of this body that God has placed in you, in unity, it's an action word.
All
Right. So can I say it now? Unity is an actual one.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
To be a part of this body.
Yeah.
You gotta do some things.
Yes, sir.
There's gotta be. See, the church been lacking for too long, Pastor.
All right.
We haven't been exercised. But to now, from what Paul is telling us in the text, we gotta be able to start exercising the gift that God has required for us to do.
Amen.
In order for us to go to the next level, we got to exercise.
Amen.
So let's get to work.
Amen.
Let's get to work.
Amen.
Let's start doing that stuff Richard Simmons started doing in the Word. Let's start praying.
Amen.
Let's start teaching.
Amen.
Let's start reaching.
Amen.
Let's start reaching the people
Amen.
And let them know that dying world that Jesus saved.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
That is only Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Unity. Unity. It's a doing.
Amen.
All hands above, eyes above.